and everybody. Good morning. Hey guys, we got a weird schedule this morning. It's a little different. So if you could get seated, it'll make things go a little better. Jeff and Lori aren't here this morning. They're down in San Diego. I checked the weather there. It's 66 degrees and it's not raining. It's slightly cloudy. This morning, instead of starting with announcements, we're going to start with worship. Our brother John is here with us this morning, and he's going to lead us in some songs. And then he's got a jet out of here, so that's why you won't see him after that. But let's pray, and then we'll stand and worship. Father God, we are so grateful for the opportunity that we have to walk into your throne room and sing your praises, Lord. You made us clean by the blood of Jesus. You made us worthy to be in your presence. And so, Lord, we want to take that opportunity that we have right now this morning and sing your praises. Lord, I pray that you'd be blessed by our worship and that we would be blessed by you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand.
Clapping is allowed today, by the way, as long as it's on the 2 and the 4. For me. Amen. I just want to say that it was rather impressive that you caught your bass as it was falling out of your hands. Who says there can't be a little bit of rock and roll in church, right? That reminds me of this song here. It says, you're never gonna let me go. You're never gonna let me down, right? And honestly, sometimes I sing that and I go, well, I don't always feel like that. I feel sometimes like I'm let down, you know? But I think it's this self-fulfilling prophecy where, you know, and we speak those words and we know that ultimately God's not going to drop us, you know? He's not. We might feel like everything's broken, but he's not gonna drop us. I love that.
Let me down. You're never gonna let
the night is holding on to me. God is holding on. When the night is holding on to me, God is holding on. Amen.
You're the Lord of victory. fights are dim, fights are night. You are fighting for the lives you died to save. Anytime, Lord. Anytime, Lord. Anytime. Anytime, Lord. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best, Lord, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence I lie. Riches I need not, no man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance now and always. Thou and thou only first in my heart. I, King of heaven, my treasure thou
Lord God, thanks for waking us up this morning. Yeah, breathing life into us physically, but also, Lord, just breathing a different kind of life into us. You said that you came so that we would have life, but not just that. We'd have it abundantly. God, you don't do things in small ways. You do them in big ways. You make too much fish and bread. You make too much wine at the wedding. You're a God of abundance. And so we want to tap into that today, Lord. And we want to thank you for life. But we want to know more and more what abundant life is. And Lord, we want to know more and more who you are. And we're grateful. And we love you. Amen. All right, you guys can have a seat.
Thank you again, John, for being here. Let's give John a thank you from Simple Truth for making it work this morning so he could lead us in worship. So, children's ministry, you guys are free to go. And like I said, we're going to do our announcements next. Whenever I cover for Jeff, it's always announcements that gets me. Like, I don't know. Like, I get to, like, kind of panic a little bit up here when it's just announcements, and then I can go and sit down in the back and, you know, mellow out, and then I'm okay when I'm teaching. But now I'm going to panic and then just roll right into teaching. All right, what are we doing here? Announcements. Yeah, thank you. I'm just trying to see if there's anything that I really need to hit on, because I haven't looked at these before, like right now. And I'm also thinking about, man, this paper is really nice. It's high quality paper. I don't see anything that's out of the ordinary. So we are just rolling into all of the stuff that we always do. We have our women's ministry that's doing their new, you guys are starting a new Bible study, right? On, it's Wednesday mornings, isn't it? Man. Wednesday meeting at Karen Kinney's house, 9:30 in the morning. Am I different than what it says there? It says Tuesday over there. That's prayer. You guys want to do announcements? Maybe this would just go a lot better for me. That's what's on Wednesdays. It's the BSF is going on Wednesdays. Michelle could have corrected me on that one. That is at the, what? Come on now. There we go. Tuesdays at 6:30, the Bell Road campus, or Wednesdays at 9:30. It feels kind of weird being in front of the screen when I'm doing announcements. Can you guys see those when you're sitting down? No? We still need children's ministry volunteers. The more people we have, the more eyes and ears we can have in the classrooms with our kids and, you know, playgrounds, everything else, that's a lot better. So it's actually a piece of cake. Like, whenever I'm free, I go and just hang out in there. And I kind of figure I'm building the next youth group eventually when they get old enough. And it's just fun, you know, like some of the kids are, you know, wanting to get into stuff they're not supposed to, so you just redirect them and sit them down. And there's always somebody else doing the Bible study and stuff for them, so I just get to be there and be a helping hand. And that's what they really need, and it's just fun. So the other thing that goes on a weekly basis is the midweek study, Wednesday night. That's me, 5 o'clock. I've heard... Somebody was telling me today that they were having a hard time finding it, showing up on Wednesday nights, like so they can't watch it live. Somebody else have that problem? You did? I don't know what the deal is. Yeah. I would have to look into this, and I didn't realize this was a problem before this morning. I think there's a way that you can go onto our Facebook page and have it notify you whenever anything is going on with that Facebook page. And I always start 5 minutes before I actually start, and you get to reenact the awkwardness of me just trying to figure out what to say before I start teaching for 5 minutes. So if you know, I start at 5, if you see it like 4:57, oh, I missed it, you know, he's already started. No, I started just so I can monologue for a few minutes and everybody can join, so. I think you can get the website or the Facebook page to give you notifications when I start something. And then it would do it also for Sunday mornings if you are, you know, not able to be here in person on Sunday mornings. It should do that also. If you can't figure that out, and I know that I would struggle with that also, send me a text or message us through Facebook Messenger or whatever else, and we'll see if we can walk you through that. I don't mind being tech support, so I can try to figure that out with you. The other thing we always do this morning is we pray for the people around us who are in need. And I got a new one, Tammy's mom, Sandy, and it's on my hand. Every time, like when I gesture like this, you'll see Sandy written on my hand. Remember to pray for Sandy, because she just had open heart surgery on Friday, and they're kind of taking things slow to get the tube out of her, you know, for breathing and stuff like that because of her age. So be praying for Sandy. She's 81. That was her birthday. She got open heart surgery for her birthday on Friday. So we be praying for Sandy. We are praying for Israel, of course, and the things that are going on there. Absolutely bonkers. Please remember also to keep Jennifer Triplett in prayer. You know, she's waiting for a liver transplant. So as long as she holds steady on that, that's, you know, whenever there's something like that that's big, the other organs start to have trouble too. So the sooner that happens, the better. Did you have something? Beautiful.
In fact, one of the ships, they just got their boxes, which they're very pleased because they've been rationing food. So.
Nice. Do you guys hear that? The boxes that we prepared as, you know, for the troops, they just are now getting them, which is very convenient timing because on some of the ships, they're already rationing food. So they just got boxes from us with snacks and stuff like that in them. So that's really nice. So with that, let's pray. Oh, and our obviously our servicemen and women, that we're going to be praying for them as well. Thanksgiving baskets are coming up. Did I miss that? Thank you. Oh, and women's conference on the 4th. Anything else that I should have said? All right. That's okay. Let's pray. Lord God, we are grateful again that we could be here, that we could gather in your name, and we can worship you, and we can worship you also by studying your word. Lord, I pray that you would be our teacher this morning, that you would open up our hearts and minds to hear from you, and that we would learn to apply your word to our lives. And Lord, for those who are sick or are hurting among us, Lord, I think specifically of Sandy, Lord, as she needs to progress enough that she can get that breathing tube out, Lord, I pray that you would give her strength. I pray that you would give the doctors wisdom to move her along and what she needs to do. And Lord, for those among us who are grieving the loss of a loved one, especially, Lord, I think now, Lord, I ask that you would be their comforter and their strength, Lord. And Lord, we are concerned. We have a heavy heart for the troops that we know and love who are deploying, who are overseas, who are on their way or might get called up. Lord, I pray that you would put your hedge of protection around those men and women. I pray that you would bless them, especially this morning, that they would be in some way or another know that we're praying for them and that you are their provider and that you care for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. So this morning we're going to be in Acts chapter 14. We've been going through Acts on the Wednesday night midweek studies. And today, this morning, we're going to catch up with Paul and Barnabas as they are on the road during their first missionary journey. They started off in their home church, which is in Antioch of Syria. And from there, they went to Cyprus, and they kind of preached their way across the island of Cyprus. And then they left Cyprus to go to a different Antioch, which is in modern-day Turkey. And on Wednesday, I said, hey, I don't know why there's so many Antiochs in the ancient world, but I found out they were named after, oh man, I forgot the guy's name, like something like Seleucus or something. He founded the cities of Turkey and named them after his dad, Antiochus. So there's Antioch. So That's as far as we have gone in our Wednesday night studies. They were in the second Antioch in modern-day Turkey. And these two guys have had some successes, and they've also struggled with a lot of different kinds of failures or opposition or difficulties that have come up. There was a fake sorcerer guy named Elamus that was in Cyprus, and he tried to oppose the gospel, and that was the guy that Paul said, hey, you're going to have to be led around by the hand for a while, and he went temporarily blind. And then their helper, John Mark, right after this, he decided, hey, I'm done with this, guys, and he went home. He abandoned them. He abandoned the work that he had committed himself to. And so they've had some setbacks, including in Antioch. The second Antioch that they went to, they were preaching there, and they met with more organized opposition from the Jewish leaders of the synagogue there. And after 2 weeks of preaching in the synagogue in Antioch, Paul and Barnabas said, hey, if you guys don't want this, then we're going to go ahead and just hang out with the Gentiles. And so they went and moved to just kind of hanging out and being primarily with the Gentiles in Antioch. And that went all right until the Jewish leaders got jealous of their success and their popularity there, and they organized the town against them, and they drove them out of town. So that's where we pick up in Acts chapter 14. And as we read through Acts chapter 14, what happened in Antioch ends up being more of an established pattern for how people react to the gospel when it shows up in their town. Paul and Barnabas would arrive. They would begin to preach. Some people would be really excited to hear the gospel. Usually a greater number of people would be upset about the gospel, and enough persecution would get churned up that they would have to leave. So as we go through Acts 14 and we see this pattern repeat itself several times, we're also going to watch Paul and Barnabas and the way that these two men conduct themselves through all of that difficulty and all the success. It gives us a lot of principles for ministry that we can copy into our own lives, things that we should be doing in our own mission field. We all serve in some way or another the way that God has called us. And so Paul and Barnabas demonstrate a lot of these principles that we're going to be able to take on board and use in the way that God uses us. So here we are, Acts 14, starting in verse 1. It says, now, at Iconium, they entered together into the Jewish synagogue and spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So they remained for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the word of his grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. So the first principle that we can learn from Paul and Barnabas here in Iconium is perseverance. They had just been driven away from Antioch by persecution, and it says at the end of chapter 13 that they shook the dust from their feet off, and they continued on. They persevered, and they continued to preach when they got to Iconium. And then at Iconium, they had a great number of people who believed, which is awesome, but the Jews who were in charge of the synagogue there didn't believe, and they began to spread lies about Paul and Barnabas. They poisoned the minds of the people around them, and they started to orchestrate this greater persecution against Paul and Barnabas. And so what did Paul and Barnabas do? It says they remained there for a long time. Serving God in whatever way that he has you to serve is usually not the way that makes a lot of people like you. Usually you end up making enemies whenever you obey the Lord in how he calls you. I remember when I first joined Simple Truth, I wasn't here at the very beginning. And it was kind of wild in the early days. There was a lot of people who were angry at the fact that we were a church. We weren't even doing anything but just minding our own business, but people didn't like that. And I had known Jeff for a long time before Simple Truth, and so I knew not to believe the poison that was going around about him. But eventually, you know, I came on board and I began to be a pastor here as well, And then I found that people are spreading poison about me also. And, you know, again, just minding my own business, just doing what the Lord has for me, and people are spreading lies about me. And just, I know people are going to ask me, people thought that I was trying to steal people from other churches to get them to come here, which was weird. But my reaction to that was kind of just like, okay, you know, who cares? I've served the Lord before. I've had rumors go around about me before and the different churches that I've been a part of. It seems like every time there's a new church, somebody gets mad about it. And you know what? That's just the way things are going to go. People are going to spread poison about you. People are going to spread lies. And there's no getting away from that. And so we just have to remember we're not here to please people. You know, you're not going to make people happy. So we just serve the Lord, and that's what we are concerned with. We are trying to please the Lord. And we have Paul and Barnabas here as good examples. They didn't quit just because people were spreading poison about them. They kept going. They persevered. There was, you know, not just people who were angry at them in Iconium. There was also people who believed. And so they stayed, and they ministered to them, and they continued to preach and teach for a long while. Verse 4. But the people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews and some with the apostles. When an attempt was made by both Jews, Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to mistreat them and to stone them, they learned of it and fled to Lystra and Derbe, cities of Iconia, and to the surrounding country. And there they continued to preach the gospel. So their mixed success in Iconium ended up dividing the city between people who supported the apostles and people who supported the opposition to the apostles, but it united the people who were opposed to the apostles. The Gentiles and the Greeks decided that they were going to get together to mistreat and stone Paul and Barnabas. And that's a really nice way of putting, they were going to torture them to death. That was the plan there. They were going to beat them for a while, and then they were going to throw rocks at them until they were dead. That was the plan. And not to spoil the story too much, but we're going to get to more mistreating and stoning when the missionaries get to Lystra. But when Paul and Barnabas learn that this was the plan, they decide to leave. And so that's the next principle that we can learn, which is discernment. So a lot of people think that any sort of pulling back or discernment, it equates cowardice, or that they were retreating. And they think that martyrdom, just standing and letting yourself be killed, is the only right way, the only honorable way to conduct yourself when persecution arises. But it's not brave to stand in front of an oncoming train. It's stupid. And so Paul and Barnabas realize, hey, there's nothing that's going to be gained by us sacrificing ourselves here, just letting ourselves be murdered. But because they had the brains to get out of the way of the oncoming train, they were able to continue. They were able to go on to Lystra and to Derbe and to continue to preach the gospel. And just so that we're clear, this wasn't a matter of fear. They weren't running away because they were afraid of pain. They weren't afraid to die. This was a thing that Paul and Barnabas lived with everywhere they went from here on out. And towards the end of his life, Paul talked about his attitude towards death. And of course, here's Philippians, right? You guys knew, if you've got a bingo card from when Tom preaches, we're going to quote Philippians. You can check that one off. Philippians chapter 1, verse 21 through 24, it says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account." So Paul was facing death in jail in the book of Philippians as he's writing that book. And he says, hey, you know what? It would be better for me to go ahead and die. I would prefer that. That would be my choice. But it's better for the church at large, for you, if I can stay and continue to serve. And so that was his attitude towards death. He wasn't afraid of it. There's no sting of death for the believer anymore. Christ has already taken it for us. And so when they were getting out of the way of this danger, they weren't running scared, but they weren't putting themselves in danger intentionally anyway. And so they were using discernment. By this point, Paul and Barnabas had already been in Iconium for a long while, and they had already preached the gospel. They had already been bold there. They had already done signs and wonders and everything else. And so they decided, hey, you know what? Maybe it's a good time for us to move on. And so they did. Verse 8. Now at Lystra, there was a man sitting who could not use his feet. He was crippled from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul speaking, and Paul, looking intently at him and seeing that he had faith to be made well, said in a loud voice, "Stand upright on your feet." And he sprang up and began walking. So Paul and Barnabas arrive, and they immediately start doing what they always do. They're preaching the gospel. It doesn't seem to me like they were in a synagogue of any kind. They were just in public somewhere. It looks like the primary audience was Gentiles rather than Jews in a synagogue. And as Paul is preaching, he notices this man who can't use his legs, never has been able to use his legs. And there's something about him, it doesn't say exactly what, but he knew that this man had faith to be healed. So that's the next principle that we're going to talk about, faith. Because it wasn't just the man who had faith, it was Paul who had faith as well. We just talked about in Iconium how signs and wonders had been done through Paul and Barnabas when they were there. It doesn't say exactly what kinds of signs and wonders they were doing, but I tend, well, okay, this is just my opinion. So you can take this or leave it, right? In my opinion, if they had done signs of healing, Luke probably would have recorded that. And I say that because in the Gospel of Luke, Luke always tends to emphasize that there was a healing that was done. It's different than just the signs and wonders. And the reason I am even bringing this up is that if that's true, if they hadn't done a miracle of healing when they were in Iconium, this is probably the first time that Paul has ever healed anybody. It's never recorded any other time before this, but he's out in public, he sees a man, and something prompts him, hey, you should heal that man. And, you know, Paul knows that Jesus has healed people. It's gotten around probably by this point that Peter has healed people, but Paul never has, in my opinion, right? Again, take it or leave it. But Paul realizes as he's in this situation that it doesn't matter if he's done this before. It doesn't matter if it's a thing that he has a lot of practice at or not. It's not like you can get good at performing the sign of healings or miracles. It's the thing that God does or God doesn't. It's not dependent on the power of Paul. It's dependent on the power of God. And so Paul has faith in the power of the Lord, and he uses that faith boldly. He knows that God isn't restricted by the things that Paul has done before. And even if Paul has done this before, if it's the first time or the 20th time, he's out in public and takes boldness to say something like, hey, why don't you stand up? He never has before, never in his life. It takes boldness to exercise that faith. And says that the Lord healed that man, and he didn't just stand up, but he jumped up and he began walking around the crowd, and the crowd pretty much lost their minds. Verse 11. And when the crowd saw what Paul had done, they lifted their voices, saying in Lyconium, "The gods have come down to us in the likeness of men." Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. And the priests of Zeus, whose temple was at the entrance to the city, brought oxen and garlands to the gate and wanted to offer sacrifice with the crowds. But when the apostles, Barnabas and Paul, heard of it, they tore their garments and rushed out into the crowd, crying out, "Men, why are you doing these things? We are also men of like nature with you, and we bring you good news that you should turn from these vain things to a living God who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. In past generations, he allowed all the nations to walk in their own way, yet he did not leave himself without witness. For he did good by giving you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons, satisfying your hearts with food and gladness. Even with these words, they scarcely restrained the people from offering sacrifices to them. I'm going to go out on a limb and say this was probably the weirdest experience of their lives. You know, they're just doing what God called them to do. They're preaching the gospel. Paul sees a man, and he knows that God wants to heal him, and he heals him. And then the crowd starts talking to each other. They don't know what's going on. They're speaking in Lyconian, so Paul and Barnabas don't understand it. But they're like, hey, man, these guys are gods. That's Zeus. That must be Hermes. And the first thing that they realize that something weird goes on is the priest is bringing out bulls and garlands, and he's got a big knife, and it's about time to sacrifice. And man, weird, right? Here's the next principle that we're going to talk about, humility. Because when you serve the Lord, when you obey the calling that God has given you, every once in a while, people are going to say, hey, you're great. You've done something awesome. You are a good person. And they want to take the things that God does and give you praise for them. Now, a lot of times, most of the time, I would say, people just want to be grateful. You know, they just want to express gratitude. Hey, thanks for coming to my house and helping my family. And that's not the same thing, right? I'm not talking about that. And that's fine. Just say, hey, you're welcome. They're just, it can be awkward, right? But it becomes dangerous when they go from thank you for what you've done to you are a really great person because of the things that you've done. And that's where it gets dangerous for not just, you know, Pastor Jeff, Pastor Tom, but for everybody. When you start hearing your praises and thinking, yeah, that's actually true, and you take that glory for yourself. A long time ago, this story reminds me of a time that I was in India. The first time I went there, I joined this group of medical professionals that were going to do like a free clinic there. We had an eye doctor, we had a dentist, and we had a whole bunch of people like me who were just going to be there to help out, right? I didn't know anything. I was not a medical professional in any way, shape, or form. And most of the people that came with us were just students, college students. So it was probably the longest trip that I've taken. I think it was like 18 hours of flying time plus long layovers in between. And then we arrived in the middle of the night in Hyderabad, and they bustled us into like these SUVs. There weren't enough seats. I ended up, because I was, you know, I'm a small guy, so I ended up in the trunk with the luggage of the SUV. And the roads from Hyderabad out into the boondocks where we went at that time, they're better now, but it was like, man, somebody was trying to race the Indy 500 on Highway 49. It was ridiculous how crazy it was. So for 4 hours, I'm watching like oncoming headlights as, you know, my car is trying to pass other cars, and we zoom in right before. And it, you know, I got tired of it. Like, I almost died 10 times in the last 30 minutes. I'm just going to try to go to sleep. And eventually, at like 5 in the morning, the sun's starting to come up, and we roll into town where we're going to have this clinic, right? We're blasted. We're just completely shattered by the whole trip. And they pull over on the outskirts of town and say, hey, we want you to walk into town, right? Because the people in town, they have prepared a welcome for you, and they want to welcome you into town. You got to be kidding me. Okay. So we get out. There's, I don't know, maybe 15 of us, and we start walking into town, and we can hear drums in the distance. And I'm not joking. A parade just enveloped us as we walked into town. They brought out these big, heavy garlands and put them around our necks. They were like 4 feet long. There was flowers thrown into the air, and there was a drum group that were all pounding on drums. They did like a human pyramid as they were playing the drums. It was the weirdest experience of my life. Just, what is going on, guys? I haven't slept in 3 days, and this is how, like, you welcome us into town. So they kind of escort us into the compound where we're going to be staying, and we ended up kind of just hanging around with a bunch of the people that had done this parade for us in there. And I came to understand that they thought, some of the people were hired to be there. So it wasn't like this spontaneous, like, oh, we're so glad that you're here. But the people that were there all thought that we were some crack team of medical specialists, and we were going to come and like solve all of the problems of the town. So I was talking with this group of men, and they kept asking me, like, what degrees do you have, and what's your specialty, what is your job? And man, I'm a janitor. I don't have any degrees. And it was so hard to get them to understand. They didn't know what the word janitor was. And finally, you know, you can tell in India the caste of different people by the way that they're dressed. Men, especially. If a man's wearing, like, pants with two legs, he's in a higher caste. If they have anything at all on their feet, they're in a higher caste. If they're barefoot, they're low caste. And the lower caste men would wear more of like a wrap around. It almost looked like they all got out of the shower. And I don't mean that disrespectfully, but that's like they wrapped a towel around their waist. And so finally, I saw a guy that was like that. He was wearing a towel thing around his waist, and he was sweeping leaves in like the gravel parking lot area. And I said, that's me. That's what I do. And the look on their faces when they realized that they had put a garland on me and they had welcomed me into town like I was a surgeon or something was like, oh, we wouldn't have bothered. You know, like, yeah, you shouldn't have bothered. This is weird, man. Can I just go to bed? It was, you know, the way that they had ascribed greatness to somebody that was just a servant was, you could see the light come in on their eyes. And I think Paul and Barnabas had such a greater misunderstanding because they didn't think that they were some kind of surgeons. They thought that they were Zeus and Hermes, Greek gods, and then they were going to like call down lightning or something if they didn't offer the right sacrifices. And it would have been the easiest thing in the world to allow the crowd to just, all right, whatever. We can't stop this. You guys are all speaking a different language from us. You already have the bulls. You might as well just do what you want to do. Right? Sure. Give us gifts. Sure. Whatever. Maybe we can sort it out another time. But Paul and Barnabas had the right perspective of who they were. They had humility. They recognized, hey, look, nothing about us is great. I'm not great. You're not great. We're all dirt. Just, we're people, just like you. And so they did as much as they could possibly do to talk the crowd down from this. Hey, please don't sacrifice to us. We're just people. God actually sent us here to deliver you from exactly this kind of thing. You don't need to sacrifice to gods that don't even exist. He has something better for you. So humility is recognizing that about yourself. And when we serve the Lord, it's not because we are, you know, something special or whatever. We're just people obeying the Lord, and the things that God does, God does. It's not us. The power doesn't come from us. You know, when you solve a situation that's going crazy with your neighbors or whatever, it's not because God made you such a great conflict resolver. It's because God resolves conflicts, stuff like that. So there are, unfortunately, plenty of God's servants who have the wrong idea about themselves, right? And I don't even need to give examples because I know everybody in here has been around some, you know, deacon or some senior pastor or somebody who has had the wrong idea about themselves. And they go from God uses me to do great things to God uses me because I'm great. You know that person. I don't even have to say names because you all have a different person in your mind, but people do that. And so instead of that, we just recognize God is the one who does great things, and sometimes I just get to be a part of it. So Paul and Barnabas talked the crowd down. They probably went to their room at night and just, whew, that was weird, huh? And then it gets weirder. Verse 19. But Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, and having persuaded the crowds, they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing that it was dead. I know it's horrible, right? I know that this was a terrible thing that happened to Paul. But I think it is just slapstick comedy hilarious that Lystra went from, wow, you are obviously you must be Hermes, not Zeus, right? To, let's throw rocks at that guy. Like, just in a day, they go from one to the other. Paul is, you can't get higher praise from a crowd than for them to think, you must be a God incarnate, right? That's high praise. You are doing a good job, Paul. And then you can't get lower criticism than them having thrown rocks at you. Tomatoes is bad enough, I guess, but having them throw rocks at you until they thought you were dead, that's pretty harsh criticism. And Paul got both of those extremes in just 2 days. And maybe it was longer. It's not really that specific, but it's funnier to me if it happens from one day to the next. So it's a good thing that Paul wasn't hung up on what people thought about him. He had enough people that were, they were so angry with his message that they followed him around. The Jews came from Antioch and Iconium because they were so mad about the things that they decided to follow him around. And then this crowd that was so excited about him just the day before, they're so fickle that as soon as somebody shows up in town, hey, that's, Paul is actually not a nice guy. Oh, okay, let's throw rocks at him. That's a good idea. And so, you know, if Paul wasn't humble, if he didn't have that humility, if he was worried about the things that people thought about him, about the criticism that he received or the praise that he got, this would have been the end of his ministry career, right? People don't like me enough to throw rocks at me. Okay, I guess I'm done with that. But Paul wasn't worried about that, and so that wasn't the end of his ministry. Verse 20, but when the disciples gathered around him, he rose up and entered the city. And on the next day, he went with Barnabas to Derbe. When they had preached the gospel to that city, they had made many disciples. They returned to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch, strengthening the souls of the disciples, encouraging them to continue in the faith, and saying that through many tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of God. And when they had appointed elders for them in every church, with prayer and fasting, they committed them to the Lord in whom they believed. Then they passed through Pisidia and came to Pamphylia. And when they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia. Yeah. And from there, they sailed to Antioch, from where they had been commended to the grace of God for the work that they had fulfilled. So they went on. And think about the bravery that it would take Paul to get up and walk back into that town. You know, and the disciples, they followed the drag lines of Paul out into the wilderness because the crowds threw rocks at him and then dragged him out there, figuring, hey, it's better for him to rot out here than in town. They just dragged him out into the woods, and they stand around Paul. They think it's his corpse, right? He must have been just filthy with blood, dust just caked all over him, and he gets up. Let's go back into town, guys. Just follow the drag lines back into town, and Paul and Barnabas were probably sitting in their hotel room again. Man, that was weird. Maybe tomorrow let's go somewhere else. But again, it wasn't for fear. The worst had already happened, right? They just said, hey, you know what? They don't want us here. Let's move on. And they do. They keep on preaching. And attempted murder wasn't a big enough deal for them to stop. And the reason for that is because for Paul and Barnabas, nothing had actually changed. The reason that they decided to preach in Derbe was the same reason that they had gone on the missionary journey in the first place. They left Antioch because they were going out to obey the Lord in the way that he had called them. He said, hey, I want you to serve me by preaching the gospel in all these towns. And that was still the same. And so this is the principle that ties all of the other ones that we've talked about this morning together. We're not out to serve people. We're out serving the Lord. And you can see that happen with Paul and Barnabas. That's why they could have perseverance when they were driven from one town to the next. They persevered because they weren't serving people. They were serving the Lord. That's why they had discernment, right? Because they weren't worried about if someone was going to kill them or not, but they wanted to be useful to the Lord, and so they used their discernment. That's why they could have faith and boldness. When God called Paul to heal that person, he had faith because it wasn't his power that he was worried about. He was serving the Lord. God is going to take care of it. And that's why they could have humility. because they knew it's not me. It's not something great about myself. I'm just a person. And so we're serving the Lord. We're going to continue to do that. And none of that changed when the crowd tried to murder Paul. That was not affected by what they had decided to do. They were going to obey the Lord to preach the gospel. They did it in Lystra. Now that's done. Let's go and continue on and do it in Derbe. So Paul and Barnabas, they weren't worried about human approval. They were worried about serving the Lord. That was their focus. That was the thing that everything else hung from for them. We're going to go and serve the Lord. And so they're going to preach the word even when it makes them enemies, which is what Jesus told us was going to happen, right? It's not like this is some new unexpected event. Jesus had told all of us that this would happen when we preach the gospel. This is Matthew chapter 10, verse 34 through 39. Jesus said, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a person's enemies will be those of his own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." So Jesus told us, hey, there's going to be division. There's going to be problems when you go out and preach the gospel. And there's degrees to that response. You know, some people are, they hear the gospel and they just think, yeah, that's not for me. And other people are, they hear the gospel and they are so opposed to it, it's not for me, but it's not for any of these people either, and I'm going to chase you out of town, and if that doesn't work, then I'm going to throw rocks at you. There's degrees, right? But none of that changes what God has called us to do. He called us to be his servants. He called us to preach the gospel, and that doesn't change with the reaction of the people around us. So Paul and Barnabas learned this, and they just kept going. And after they went to Derbe, they got a little break in Derbe, by the way. Nobody followed them there. Nobody ran them out of town. Kind of like vacation, probably, for them. After that, they decide, hey, you know what? Let's go back to all those places that we started in. And you can see it wasn't fear that made them leave, because they go back. They go back to Lystra, where Paul got stoned. They go back to Iconium, and they go back to Antioch, where the Jews had followed Paul around just to make sure that he got mistreated. And it says that all of those places, they encouraged the people. They had the visual aid of Paul's beaten up face as, hey, we must through many tribulations enter the kingdom of God. And they appointed elders for all of those churches so that the ministry could continue. And they recognized that ministry isn't just an act of a moment, but it's a thing that happens over a lifetime. I was thinking about this when Billy Swan was here, and he was talking about the program that they have. And I went to help with one of their like summer camps there a long time ago. And it was, I think we had 7 to 9 year old boys, and there was 25, there was 25 boys, 7 to 9 years old. And I think we had 12 adults that came to help with that camp from California. And so that's 2 to 1, right? 2 kids, 1 adult. We were barely able to keep them from pummeling each other to death every single day. I counted how many fistfights we as a group broke up. It was 50. Each kid got into 2 fistfights a day. And I thought, man, what are we doing out here? Like, how is this doing anybody any good? I saw Brian Anderson pick a hammer out of a kid's hand as he was running into one of the fights. Like, the kid was going to brain people with a hammer. 7 or 8 years old. And Billy Swan actually sat down with us and said, hey, you're seeing like a tiny little part of the ministry here. And we have these boys from when they're like 6 to when they're graduating from their version of high school, and then some of them even into adulthood. And I just thought, yeah, okay, if that's what you do, that's good for you. There was a kid that when he got picked up, I've told this story before, I made sure that I had a car in between me and his parents, because he had told me, my dad's going to stab you when he comes to pick me up. And I thought, yeah, he might. He might. I mean, I know the kid. I know where he comes from now. I'm going to make sure there's a car in between me and that kid's dad. That's discernment. I don't want to get stabbed. So ministry is it's a matter of a lifetime. And I realized that like 15, 20 years later when somebody posted pictures of that camp on Facebook just not very long ago. And I saw the kids, I recognized the names, like that kid was the one that was going to have his dad stab me. And he's got a family, he's got little kids of his own, and he seems to be doing well. The last I heard, he was in jail for selling drugs, and like he sorted himself out. And some of those other kids actually ended up growing and being old enough to come back, and they wanted to serve after that as counselors and help other kids learn to follow the Lord at a young age, and they got to be the ones breaking up the fights. So ministry happens over a life, right? Not over just a moment. Like sometimes you get to be a tiny part of somebody's life, changing a flat tire for somebody on the side of the road, or, you know, they've got a huge family issue and you show up and help in the house, you know, whatever it is. Maybe you just bring meals to somebody who needs meals. Those things are part of a lifetime of ministry that we do. And it's not like we talked about serving people or preaching the gospel to people on Wednesday night as like a checklist. Like God told me to preach the gospel, so that's what I got to do to you. But we miss the heart of the gospel. We talked about that on Wednesday night. The heart of the gospel is loving care for people and helping them through all of life. And so Paul and Barnabas, they recognize that. And so when they go back through, they make sure that the churches that they started are going to continue. They're not worried about being in charge of those churches and having authority over them. They just, hey, you guys know what to do. Now, here's some elders. They're going to take care of you. Continue on. So they do that on their way back to Antioch, where they started. Verse 27. And when they had arrived, they gathered the church together, and they declared all that God had done with them and how he had opened a door of faith to the Gentiles, and they remained no little time with the disciples. The last principle that we see here is that when we serve the Lord, we do it as a body. We do it together. Nobody is out there serving the Lord on their own. Paul and Barnabas had been the ones that God sent out to go and preach the gospel. So they were the ones that got to be, you know, out front. People saw them. People knew who they were. But they only got to go because the church sent them out. And you see that when Paul and Barnabas got chosen to go up and preach the gospel, Paul and Barnabas weren't the ones who heard the message that was what was going to happen. The church heard the message. The church was together in prayer, and God told the church, I want you to take Paul and Barnabas and send them out. And so the church sent them out and commissioned them and sent them. And we all have different roles in the church, right? Paul and Barnabas got to be missionaries. The rest of the church got to be senders of missionaries. But we all serve the Lord together. Paul did write the book of Romans, sorry. Book of Romans, chapter 10, Paul talked about this, verse 14 and 15. He says, how are they to hear without someone preaching, and how are they to preach unless they are sent? Right? There's no missionaries without churches sending out missionaries. Some people are called to be those missionaries. Some people are called to be the senders. In the book of Acts, we see that the apostles, God used the apostles to minister in the word of God in prayer. And he used the deacons to minister in making sure that the people who had needs had those needs fulfilled. But no group worked without the others. It was part of a group effort. The whole body is working together. We don't serve the Lord alone. We serve the Lord as a body together. So when Paul and Barnabas get back to Antioch, they gather everybody together and tell them the news. And it's basically one of those like, hey, look what we all got to do together. Thank you for sending us. Here's the things that God did through us, and they can all rejoice together because they were obedient in the service of the Lord. Paul and Barnabas were obedient when God sent them out into danger, and the church was obedient when God told them, hey, I want you to separate these guys and send them out. So That's Acts chapter 14. It's a little weird when we get to the end and there's no song, right? But I'm going to pray, and then I want to read a psalm to you. It's not a song, but it's a psalm. I don't have it. Sorry for projection, so you guys can just listen. But let's pray. You're going to be really fast. It is Psalm 112. Watch how the body works together now. Lord, I thank you for the examples that we have of Paul and Barnabas as we see them serving you, as we see them being obedient to you and persevering and having humility and having faith and just obeying you when you said, hey, go and preach the gospel. And they did, Lord, and you did great things for them. And when opposition came, when people were against them, they remembered that, hey, they weren't there for other people. They were there to please you and to do what you had called them to do. And so, Lord, we want to take that on board. Lord, we want to be the people who obey you. We want to be the people who get used by you. And so, Lord, we know that there's nothing great about us. Lord, there's nothing about any of us that's better than the pile of dirt out in the parking lot. But, Lord, you want to use us. And so we want to be obedient to that be used by you to help, to bless the people around us. Lord, bring more people into your kingdom through our hands and our feet and the voices that we have to share with them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, I'm going to read Psalm 112. Praise the Lord. Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. His offspring will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. Light dawns in the darkness for the upright. He is gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with the man who deals generously and lends, who conducts his affairs with justice. For righteousness will never be moved. He will remember forever. For the righteous will never be moved. He will be remembered forever. He is not afraid of bad news. His heart is firm, trusting in the Lord. His heart is steady. He will not be afraid until he looks in triumph on his adversaries. He is distributed freely. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. His horn is exalted in honor. The wicked man sees it and is angry. He gnashes his teeth and melts away. The desire of the wicked will perish. Thank you guys for being here this morning. We do have to stack chairs, but I know that I guess you guys know that already. God bless you guys. Thank you.